On behalf of the National Archives and Records Administration, it is my pleasure to welcome you to lecture number 6 of the Becoming America lecture series, titled The First Congress, Inventing a New Government. Our lecturer tonight is Joellen Chatham, the director for the Center for Civics Education at Concordia University in Irvine. Her and her colleagues have worked tirelessly to craft an educational and entertaining lecture series. The lectures will last 45 minutes with a question and answer format to follow. So if you have any questions, please email me at rachel.fisher@nara.gov. And now please help me in welcoming Dr. Joellen Chatham.
Thank you. Again, thanks to NARA, the National Archives at the Richard Nixon Library, for your continued help in this series. For the last last programs, we've taken you all the way from Magna Carta in 1215 up through the American Revolution and why we wanted to separate from the British, and then we did separate from the British, a deep dive into the Declaration of Independence and then the Constitutional Convention, and then last week we ratified the Constitution. And so tonight we're going to end this first part of our 18-part series by looking at the first Congress that had to implement that Constitution. I have some dates listed here. I don't expect you to remember all of them, but it gives you a timeline of what has happened since the Constitutional Convention adjourned. They adjourned on September 17th of 1787, and then about 10 days later, the Confederation Congress, meeting in New York City, which had been operating under the Articles of Confederation, officially transmitted the Constitution to the states for their ratification. The first state to ratify was Delaware. They did that on December 7th. Then in March of 1788, just a few months later, Rhode Island, who totally refused to even participate in the Constitutional Convention, voted to actually reject the Constitution itself. Several other states ratified. Finally, on June 21st, New Hampshire ratified, being the ninth state required to put the Constitution into effect. Then Virginia ratified, New York ratified, and by September 13th of 1788, the Confederation Congress certifies the new Constitution. And then the first presidential elections were held sometime in December or January, depending on which state you lived in. Then on February 4th, the members of the Electoral College met in their respective states. They voted for the president. And then on February 4th, 1789, the Electoral College convened they convened to vote for president, and then the first Congress convened on March 4th. April 30th, President Washington is inaugurated, and finally, in November of 1789, North Carolina finally ratified the Constitution, and then by the end of May, Rhode Island had ratified the Constitution as well. So we see the sequence of events here, which is really important, because within less than a year, this all went into effect. Now, I like to say the Articles are dead, long live the Constitution. The city of New York at that time was about 40,000 people, located really at the southern tip of Manhattan Island. It wasn't the large metropolis that we know of it today, but it was in New York City where the Confederation Congress had met. They had finally, on March 3rd of 1789, put the Articles of Confederation to rest. And it didn't die quietly. It died, but not quietly. 13 cannon were fired at Fort George at the foot of Broadway to signify that the old government has passed, the new government is in place. As one newspaper put it, they said the co-partnership of anarchy and anti-federalism being dissolved by the death of the concerned, the firm ceases to be. The next morning at sunrise on March 4th, the day that the new Congress, the new government was to take effect, 11 guns were fired, not 13, because remember, on that day, you still don't have Rhode Island, you still don't have North Carolina. So 11 guns were fired off, and the church bells were ringing, flags were waving, the people were standing and cheering in the street. One of the members of the new Congress had also been a member of the Confederation Congress. His name was George Thatcher. And he said, "The old government has gently fallen asleep, and the new one is waking into activity." And this is just Fort George is on my right, your left. By the way, Fort George was the last place that British troops left America at the conclusion of the Revolutionary War. And then the other picture is just part of the city of New York in 1787. Now, the Constitution required that Congress would assemble once every year on the first Monday in December, unless Congress chose another date. Later, that was changed in 1933. We amended the Constitution so that it now convenes every January 3rd. The Constitution also states that the states will set the time, place, and manner of elections. However, Congress can vary those regulations from time to time, which they did. The original allocation of representatives for each state is clearly defined in Article 1 of the Constitution. They said New York will get this many representatives, Delaware will get this many, Virginia will get this many, but that would only last for the first year, because the Constitution also required that every 10 years we would take a census. And based on the number of people living in each state under the census, that a member of Congress would represent approximately 30,000 people. And if a state didn't have 30,000 people, they would still have one representative. So between in 1788 and 17, those years or those months after the Constitution was technically into effect, five states held elections in 1788 and six states held them in 1789. And again, remember, North Carolina and Rhode Island had not ratified. So 22 senators were elected, two from each state. And if you recall, originally, you and I did not vote for state senators, for U.S. senators. They were voted on, they were selected by the state legislatures. There were 59 members of the House of Representatives that were elected. Delaware had one delegate, the state of Virginia had 10. It was very different. There were no political parties in those days. We had basically people who were for the Constitution, called Federalists, people who were against the Constitution, called Anti-Federalists, but they were not organized political parties. In the House of Representatives, however, about 48 out of the 59 representatives could be called Federalist or pro-administration by the way they voted. In the Senate, 20 of the 22 would be considered today Federalists, or those who were pro-administration. So the first meeting, and this is where they met, this was Federal Hall on the on my right, your left. That is what the Federal Hall looked like in 1787. This is what it looks like today. It's obviously a different building, but it's in the same place, reconstructed in the 19th century, and is now a historical of a place where you can get information about the first Congress. Now, the first meeting of Congress was supposed to be held in that building on March 4th. The problem is they didn't have a quorum. The building itself had held the Stamp Act Congress. It had been the place where the Confederation had Congress. Confederation Congress had met since the end of the Revolutionary War, and actually during the Revolutionary War. And the building had been refurbished by Pierre L'Enfant. The building had been renamed in honor of the new government, now called Federal Hall. But the problem, there was no quorum. The House of Representatives needed 30 to begin their meetings, and on March 4th, only 13 showed up. The Senate needed 12 members in order to have a quorum, but only 8 showed up. Nevertheless, they kept coming every day until they finally had a quorum. The biggest problem with the quorum was really travel. The roads were bad. This is the dead of winter. This is in this is in March. People are just getting over, and it was a snowy, cold time. Also, there were people who had other businesses to take that had to be attended to. So they continued to straggle in. But there were some people who were very concerned about this lack of a quorum, because they didn't have a quorum until almost a month later, on April 1st. Fisher Ames, who was one of the members of Congress from Massachusetts, wrote that this is a very mortifying situation. We lose credit, spirit, everything. The people will forget the government before it is even born. One of the local newspapers called this problem of not having a quorum a disaster waiting to happen, a monarchical, aristocratical, tyrannical, diabolical system of slavery, a cabal of aristocratical men. They were pleased that there was no quorum. They were just waiting for it to fail. Finally, on April 1st, the House had its quorum. Most of the men who were representing the 11 states were in their 30s and 40s. They were young men. Most of them had Revolutionary War experience. And the first thing they did on this day was to elect Henry Muhlenberg, as the Speaker of the House of Representatives. He came from a very important Lutheran Germanic family in Pennsylvania. He was not a Lutheran pastor, but he had chaired the Pennsylvania Ratifying Convention. The Speaker in those days, however, had very little power. Today we know the Speaker is not only powerful, it's third in line to the presidency and the most important member of Congress. In these days, when Congress began, the Speaker really took on the same role or a similar role that the Speaker had in the British Parliament. Basically, they didn't vote unless there was a tie. Well, in this first Congress, there were only 5 tie votes for Henry Muhlenberg to break. So he rarely debated, rarely voted, but he did appoint committees. And during this first Congress, that lasted for 2 years off and on because they didn't meet continuously, they had at least 150 committees, and he appointed the committee members. 5 days later, on April 6th, the United States Senate finally had a quorum, and they elected John Langdon as the president pro tem of the Senate. Then you have John Adams, who was the vice president of the United States. He didn't arrive until days after that, and he was finally sworn in as Vice President of the United States on April 21st. The first thing that this new Congress did, by the way, was to certify the election of George Washington as president. The Constitution requires that the electors for each presidential election meet in their individual states. The candidate with the highest votes becomes president. The candidate with the second highest votes becomes vice president. Now, that was changed with the 12th Amendment, which we won't get into tonight. But once the electors vote in each state, the results of their elections are sent to Washington, D.C., and the Constitution requires that the House and Senate in joint session, count the electoral votes, and then certify the election of the President of the United States. So that was the first action that the new Congress took. So Congress began deliberation on a variety of subjects, but the big event that was to happen next was the inauguration of George Washington. Now, George Washington wasn't particularly pleased with being elected president. He knew he would be, but he was not looking forward to it. And upon leaving Mount Vernon for the 8-day trip to Washington, D.C., he wrote this: "About 10 o'clock in the morning, I bade adieu to Mount Vernon, to private life and domestic facility, and with a mind oppressed with more anxious and painful sensations than I have words to express, I set out for New York to render service to my country in obedience to his call, but with less hope of answering its expectations." He knew they depended on him. He wasn't sure he was up to the job, but he knew it was his duty. Before leaving, George Washington actually stopped in Fredericksburg, Virginia, to meet with his mother. They'd had a stormy relationship throughout their life, but he stopped on the way to New York to visit his mother. And one of the last things she said, because she was suffering from cancer, she said, "You will see me no more." And he never did. That was the last time he saw his mother. So the 8 days going from Mount Vernon to New York City, all along the way, there were banquets, there were parades, there were people shouting and giving all kinds of tribute to him. This was almost like the way you would treat a king. But he was the nation's indispensable man. He was almost their savior. There were parades, there were fireworks. He was met in Philadelphia with mounted troops who took him to the City Tavern, where they had an elegant banquet for about 200 people. It just went on and on. And believe it or not, he found it very tiresome, very inappropriate, but he also understood that the people felt that they needed to do this. Finally, on April 23rd, he was in Elizabeth, New Jersey, just across from New York City, and there was a group of people, members of Congress, city fathers, other dignitaries, ready to meet him and carry him across the Hudson River on a barge. And if you have time, you might just want to read about some of these ceremonies, because, for instance, there were 13 pilots on the barge, one for each state. Forget the fact that two hadn't ratified yet. They were still considered 13. So all of these symbols, just everywhere he went, there was enthusiasm among most of the people for this new government, this new experience. When he got off the barge, he declined the carriage and he decided to walk through New York City, preceded by a cavalry troop. And all along the way, banners and people shouting and singing, wreaths of flowers thrown, till he arrived at his house on Cherry Street, which had been rented for him. Now you see, he walked that long way. Remember, this is a small town, 40,000 people, second largest city in the United States, so it really was not that long of a walk. Now, one of the big issues that may not sound important to us today, but it was a big issue then, and that was how to address the president. When Vice President Adams was sworn in the Senate, one of the first issues he raised is, how do we treat the president? What do we call him? And Adams made a big deal of this beginning on April 21st, 2 days before the president arrived. Now, they debated this subject several days, and it was a very hot debate. Adams wanted to call Washington Your Exalted Highness, plus a few other adjectives along the way, Your Elective Highness, Your Most Benign Highness. And it just went on and on, and people saying that's too monarchical, this is too pedestrian. They literally had shouting debates on this. Finally, someone said, wait a minute, the new Constitution that we just ratified prohibits the conferring of titles. So in the end, they adopted the simple phrase, Mr. President. Now, on election day, on April 30th, John Adams was really upset. He didn't know how to act. He's the vice president. He has no power except to vote in the Senate if there's a tie and to preside over the Senate. But even then, he can't vote unless there's a tie. And he began to fret. How do I address the president? When he comes in, should I be standing? Should I be sitting? How should we receive him? Do we bow? How do we behave? He had no idea how to behave, but he wasn't the only one. George Washington wasn't sure how to behave. In fact, he had written to James Madison, John Jay, and Henry Knox in a letter saying, how do I interact with the public? I don't want to be like a king where nobody can approach me and everyone has to treat me with this reverence. But at the same time, I don't want to be so casual that I'm just like anybody else. How do I behave? Now, these sound so unimportant to us today, but to a government that was just starting out, and how do you please the public when the public doesn't necessarily agree on these things? So we have these crazy debates going on, but finally on April 30th, just after noon, George Washington left his residence. His hair was powdered. He was wearing a suit of American-made broadcloth, and the buttons on his costume, on his suit, were metal buttons embossed with an eagle. In other words, he wanted to appear as a common man, and yet one who was distinguished. He walked the few blocks from a federal hall from his home. He started out by horse and then left the carriage and walked again between rows of soldiers, again, people thronging to hear him and to cheer him. He entered the Senate chamber at the house that I showed you earlier. The Senate was on the second floor of Federal Hall. The House of Representatives met on the first floor, which is why we now call the Senate the upper house, not because they were more important, but because they met on the second floor. And that same continued when they met in Philadelphia. He placed his hand on a Bible, and the Bible had been secured from St. John's Masonic Lodge. As we know, Washington was a very active Mason. There were many Masons in the leadership of our government at that time. The oath was administered by the Chancellor of New York, Robert Livingston, who also happened to be a Mason. And after taking the oath, Washington kissed the Bible. He did not say, "So help me God," as some people think. That's a tradition that began later. But he kissed the Bible, and that was a tradition that all presidents followed until Eisenhower in 1953. And Eisenhower replaced kissing the Bible with a simple silent prayer. After taking the oath, which you can see in this picture being administered by Chancellor Livingston, they went into the Senate chamber where the president gave a very brief 12-minute speech. I'd encourage you to go online and read Washington's first inaugural speech. First of all, people who were there said we couldn't always hear him. He spoke hesitantly, kind of quietly. He was not known as a great orator. His skills were in other areas. But his first inaugural really conveys what he said when he said, "The weight of history lays on our collective soldiers. The destiny of the Republican model of government was entrusted to the hands of the American people." Can you imagine that? This had never been done in history, and they all knew it. And George Washington knew it as well as anyone, because he had led them through the war, he had led them through the Constitutional Convention, and now he was to lead them as their elected president. From there, they went to St. Paul's Chapel, a very short distance away, and held a brief service. By the way, you might want to look up St. Paul's Chapel. It was built in 1766, and at the time, it was the tallest building in New York City. And the rear of the chapel faces Church Street, which is the opposite of the east side of the World Trade Centers. And on 9/11, when that disaster occurred and thousands of people were killed, all of those things that happened, St. John's Chapel was not touched. Not a window was broken. And one might want to look into why that might have happened. By the way, Washington worshiped there several times during his presidency. Now, the problem with the presidency is that there's little in the Constitution to guide what the president's job is. And Washington knew that. It basically, there's more time spent in the Constitution describing how the president will be elected than what his positions are or what his responsibilities are. He's the commander-in-chief, he's the chief executive, he can issue pardons, treaty making, but treaties have to be approved by the Senate. He can make executive appointments, but at this point there's no executive department of any kind even to make appointments. So he is treading on totally untrod ground. And he said, there is scarcely any action I may take whose motives may not be subject to double interpretation. There is scarcely any part of my conduct which may not hereafter be drawn into precedent. In other words, he knew the people are watching, and whatever I do will either be criticized or become precedent. He said, I walk on untrodden ground. The first of everything in our situation will serve to establish precedent. It is devoutly wished on my part that these precedents be fixed on true principles. He was very cognizant that everything he did would be evaluated. So the first session of Congress, a lot happened. Now, there were three sessions of Congress, and we'll talk about each one of them briefly. The first official act of the Congress, which means both houses voted on something and the president signed it, was signed on June 1st of 1789, just a number of weeks after the president was inaugurated, and it was the Oath of Office Act. And that was the act that required all federal officials and the legislative members of the state legislatures to sign an oath of office. They passed the first tariff act. The government had no money. The country was literally broke. So they passed the first tariff. The Department of State was established. Regulation on the collection of duties, they established the U.S. Customs Service. The Department of War was established. Today we call it the Department of Defense. They established the Department of the Treasury, the Judiciary Act of 1789. From June 1st to the end of September, a tremendous amount was accomplished. At one point, the president, with no employees — he didn't have any employees, he brought his own secretary, Tobias Lear, but he had no employees. So he asked the heads of departments who had been heading departments under the Articles of Confederation to give him an update, give me a report. John Jay had headed the Office of Foreign Affairs under the Articles of Confederation. So he asked John Jay, send me a report about what's going on in foreign affairs and among the states. Well, Jay complied, and so did Henry Knox, who had, under the Articles of Confederation, headed the Department of War. He asked these people, just advise me, give me some information so I know what's going on. Well, this is a good thing to do, even though he couldn't appoint anybody because these departments had not yet been created. At least he was getting information. One of the things that he learned was that John Jay, Secretary of Foreign Affairs, and Henry Knox, the Secretary of War, under the Articles of Confederation, had been in the process of making a treaty with the Indians in certain parts of the country. Well, under the new Constitution, it says that treaties are made by the president, but with the advice and consent of the Senate. Well, what does that mean? When do they consent? How do they consent? So George Washington, again, nobody knowing what to do, George Washington, Knox, actually went to the Senate, physically went to the building, to get their advice and consent. The doorkeeper announced them, and they handed the treaty to the vice president, who has no power except to preside and to vote in the event of a tie, takes the treaty, and it's handed to him by the president of the United States, who is the head of the entire executive branch, who is the head of the government, who represents the country. So the first act here is the president is seemingly subordinate to the vice president. Well, Adams didn't know what to do. This had never happened before. So he kind of mumbled through the seven sections. He hadn't read them before, and he paused. Finally looked up and said to the senators, do you advise and consent? Well, senators didn't know what to do either. What does advice and consent mean? How do we do this? It had never happened before. Senator William McClay said that there were carriages outside in front of Federal Hall that were making so much noise that they had to have Adams repeat what he was saying. And others were shouting, "We repeat it, we can't hear you." So Adams again said, "Do you advise and consent?" Then Robert Morris, one of the senators and a close friend of the president, suggested, "Well, we don't know the meaning of advice and consent. We don't know how to do this, so let's send it to a committee." So again, Adams said, "Do you advise and consent?" Well, by this time, Washington is not only frustrated, he's pretty darn mad, although he cooled himself. And actually, Washington said, "This defeats every purpose of my coming here." And he marched out of the hall in sort of a sudden sullen dignity, but he was not happy. The Senate itself was embarrassed. So they created a committee to determine how communications between the president and the Senate would take place on treaties and on nominations. So they set up this committee, but George Washington, his response was a little harsher. He said the Constitution assigned treaty making to the president, and later in the Constitution to executive appointments, and Congress could approve them or reject them, but they had no visible role in making nominations or in making treaties. So George Washington said this: "As the president has a right to nominate without assigning his reasons, so the Senate has a right to dissent without giving theirs." And he refused ever again to appear before the Congress unless the entire Congress was there, not just the Senate. He would not submit to the Senate's interrogation. So later on, the Senate tried to exert their control, not only over the treaty making — this is all taken care of now, Washington took care of that — but they wanted to be able to fire executive leaders. So the president appoints the heads of departments and other federal offices, but how do you get rid of them? Do they serve for life? Do they serve during the president's tenure? Do they serve during Congress? Who can get rid of them? Can they be impeached? The Federalists, who were supportive of the president, said that since they were executive appointments, they should report to and be removable only by the president. The other side said, "No, you leave them in office until we impeach them or we let them go." George Washington insisted, "I will have the power to remove the people that I appoint." And at this point, he actually hinted his own possible resignation. So what we see here at the very beginning is a struggle between the executive branch, the president's powers, and the legislative branch, the Congress's powers. This was, these were his first appointments. He appointed Thomas Jefferson as Secretary of State. He actually wanted John Jay. John Jay had been, as I mentioned earlier, head of the foreign affairs under the Articles of Confederation. And John Jay didn't want that job anymore. He wanted to go to the Supreme Court. So the president eventually did appoint John Jay as Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. So Thomas Jefferson was his second choice for Secretary of State. And by the way, Jefferson didn't want that job either. Henry Knox was appointed as Secretary of War. They had worked very closely during the Revolutionary War. And then he chose Alexander Hamilton as his Secretary of the Treasury. And Washington said this about his nominations: "My conduct in nominations must be exceedingly circumspect and proof against just criticism, for the eyes of all are upon me, and no slip will pass unnoticed." He had many friends, many colleagues throughout the country who were asking for appointments: "Give me this job, give me this job," or another job. He accepted them only on merit, and he reviewed every one of them. And interestingly, he turned down some of his very best friends for jobs. His own nephew, Bushrod Washington, sought a job, and the president said, "I'm sorry, but you're not qualified." The man who held, who installed him as president of the United States, who administered the oath, Robert Livingston. They were close friends. And he wanted a job, and Washington, I'm sorry, this job is not for you. And that ended his friendship with Livingston. But as Washington said himself, he was very careful about these nominations. One of the first issues that Congress faced was money. The nation was broke. There was no national solvency. The French minister to the United States, and a lot of Europe was looking at us and going, yeah, this is a joke. These people aren't going to succeed. Some hoped we would, but most were just waiting for us to fail. And the French minister wrote back to Paris after 3 months. He said, the federal treasury is empty. Debts are accumulating. And in the end, the Americans will realize the absurdity, especially in matters of revenue, of wanting to make perfect laws. What were we going to do? So George Washington ordered Hamilton. He said, I want you to prepare me a document explaining the financial condition of the United States. Now, Hamilton was a banker. He had helped found a bank. He was involved in that business, so he had a good idea of finances. He was also one of Washington's most trusted advisors. So during the second session of Congress, which we'll get into in just a minute, Hamilton reported the state of the finances, and he presented this to the Congress. He said, the United States foreign debts amounted to over $11 million, about $2 million to the Dutch and the rest to the French. In domestic debts, the United States had over $42 million, including back pay to military veterans, supplies, interest on the debt, and so on. The states themselves owed about $25 million, mostly from the Revolutionary War. And the projected federal income at that time, if they could get it, was about $2.5 million. Now, these are small numbers by today's standards, but put yourself in 1787. These were big numbers. There was no source of income. So Hamilton had worked for months to prepare this document, and he wanted to present it in person to Congress and go through it. Now, remember, in those days, there were no printed copies. They just didn't run off things like we do today. And Hamilton's document was in longhand, about 51 pages. He wanted to present it to Congress so that he could answer questions and explain it. But they said, no, you're an executive, you can't come here. So they had the clerk read the report, and it was a mess. But in the end, Hamilton not only presented the state of finances, he proposed several remedies. One, he said the national government should assume the state debts. In other words, let's take all these debts we have, put them to the federal government, and let the federal government handle them. We will create a variety of taxes and tariffs to pay this debt off. He also proposed to create a national bank, but he didn't do that yet. He waited a few months because he knew that that would just be too much for the Congress to take. He proposed a number of taxes and tariffs. One of them was a whiskey tax. Now, so what's the big deal about whiskey? Except that it almost caused a rebellion in the West, because whiskey was used as a form of barter currency in much of the West. And you went out to the farmers in the West, everybody had a still. They all made it. It was much cheaper to make whiskey out of their wheat than to ship it over to the Mississippi River under the Spanish and down to the Gulf. So the whiskey tax was a big deal, and as I said, it almost caused a rebellion. Although the religious people in the United States who really didn't approve of whiskey and liquor, they kind of liked this tax. But it created a huge debate that went on for a number of weeks in Congress. And when Hamilton, who was a strong Federalist, when he used words like consolidation, nationalism, that just got people like Patrick Henry and other anti-Federalists up in arms. Madison, James Madison, a member of Congress, he had defeated James Monroe for his seat in Congress, was a major opponent of Hamilton's suggesting that all the state and national debts be combined and the federal government be responsible for it. But as these debates were going on, there's also talk of disunion. Maine wanted to separate from Massachusetts. Kentucky wanted to separate from Virginia. The western areas of Pennsylvania wanted to separate from Pennsylvania. There were actually people who were trying to negotiate with the French and with the British to associate with them. There was violence, particularly in the West. The tax collectors were literally tarred and feathered. And if you can imagine, they really did those things. Tarred and feathered and left out, and it was a terrible thing. Finally, there was an accommodation. Jefferson, who was a bitter enemy of Hamilton and a close ally of Madison, was watching this debate go on, watching the country begin to fray at the very beginning, and noticed that it wasn't just the debate over taxes, but there was another major debate going on in the Congress, and that's where will the final site of the national government be located? There were at least 16 places suggested for the national capital. So finally, Thomas Jefferson invited Hamilton and Madison to a dinner. Now remember, they're all living in New York. And through this and through negotiations that had come before, they agreed that, okay, we will make the site of the nation's capital, the permanent capital, be on the Potomac River. That's kind of in the southern part of the United States. And Madison said, okay, if you give us, meaning the South, you give us that, a southern capital for the United States, I will stop fighting you on an assumption of the state debts. And they made that deal. The Federalists were already with Hamilton, and Madison was able to bring the southern representatives along. So that's why we have the capital right off the Potomac River, situated between Maryland and Virginia. So Hamilton was able to begin to put the nation's finances in order. Now, what about the judiciary? The Constitution was very vague in Article 3, short article of the Constitution. It says there will be one Supreme Court. Other courts might be created as well. How long will judges serve? As long as they behave. The outlines of a jurisdiction of a Supreme Court, that was about it. There was very little said. A little bit was said about the jurisdiction, but the questions remain: how many justices on the Supreme Court? 2, 4, 6, 8, 12, 15? Will state courts be part of this new federal court system? Could federal courts review state laws? Could state laws review federal laws? Could judges serve on state courts and the Supreme Court or other federal courts at the same time? None of this was in the Constitution, so they had to make it up as they went along. And on September 24th, 1789, months after Washington was sworn in as president, he signed the Judiciary Act of 1789. Its principal author was Oliver Ellsworth, who had been a litigator and he had been a judge. He was at the Constitutional Convention. He had a great history in this area. And the act created one Supreme Court and five associates. The act said that the court would meet twice a year at the seat of government. So wherever the seat of government was going to be, that's where the Supreme Court would meet. And then it divided the country into 15 districts, one for each state and one for Maine and for Kentucky, which would eventually become states. And in each one of these 15 districts, each one would have a federal court, a U.S. attorney, a federal marshal, but the act did not provide for any staff. It also provided for three regional circuit courts. And the circuit courts would be composed of the district judge and two traveling members of the Supreme Court. Now, you can imagine being one of these people on the Supreme Court of the United States. And twice a year, you're going to have to go into other parts of the country. No matter what the weather is, it's kind of like delivering the mail. You've got to go hold court. This was called circuit riding. Well, the judges complained about that, and a few years later, that was gone. The Judiciary Act of 1789 also created the position of Attorney General. And what you see here is John Jay, who was appointed the first Chief Justice. Edmund Randolph is the other large picture. He became the first Attorney General. And then the others, James Wilson, John Rutledge, Robert Harrison, John Blair, and William Cushing became the first justices on the Supreme Court. By the way, George Washington nominated all of them on the same day that the Judiciary Act passed. 2 days later, they were all confirmed. Very unlike what happens in the United States today. But when Washington picked them, he was very careful. He picked the five associate justices, all from different states, and he made sure that all six, which would include the Chief Justice, three were from the North and three would be from the South. He also agreed informally that he would consult with senators before nominating someone, particularly if that someone would be from that senator state. And if they said, no, I don't want him, then he began what's called senatorial courtesy, and that still applies today. So he doesn't want to say cross a senator because of these kinds of nominations. So now we've got a Supreme Court in place. They held their first meeting the next year on February 2nd in New York City. They met in the Royal Merchant Exchange, which was a covered marketplace near Federal Hall. And the first day they met, the whole place was cleared so that they could keep the noise down and have some dignity about the court. The place was packed. People wanted to see what was going on. Many of them knew John Jay. He was from New York. The problem is, one, they didn't know how to dress. And William Cushing, now you can see there John Jay's got his robes on, but William Cushing, being kind of the old school and not knowing how they were going to dress, he showed up with a powdered wig and all of the regalia that they wore at British courts. And so many people laughed at him. They were chasing him around, making fun of him. So they all ended up really just wearing the black robe. But just as Congress had no quorum on March 4th, the Supreme Court did not have a quorum the first day that it met as well. So they met, didn't have anything to do, didn't have a quorum, so they couldn't do anything, so they left. The second day, same thing happened. They didn't have a quorum, so they left. On the third day, John Blair actually made it. He had been delayed by weather. And so they appointed a clerk of the court. They installed several members of the newly created Supreme Court bar. And then they heard their first case, which was dismissed on procedural basis. Just to point out, John Rutledge wasn't real happy. He thought he should have been made Supreme Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. And he had been governor of South Carolina. He played a major role at the Constitutional Convention. He had an incredible resume, and he thought he should have been Chief Justice. So he never showed up to any of the meetings of this first court. And in fact, he shortly resigned to become Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of South Carolina. So the first session of Congress ended at the end of September, 1789. And the second session began on January 4th and went through August of, That should be January 4th of 1790. And here they provided for the first census, which by the way was controversial because who do we count? Do we count everybody? We know that the Constitution required that 3/5 of the slaves be counted, but should people who don't pay taxes, should they be counted? So there was a big discussion who was to be counted. The Naturalization Act, who should be made a citizen? Should each state decide for itself who's a citizen, or should there be a naturalization for people for the entire United States? Big discussion about that as well. The Patent Act, the Copyright Act. In other words, when people have inventions or they write things, how do they keep them, how they keep ownership of them? They passed a Federal Crimes Act, making certain things crimes, such as stealing, committing murder on federal property, and so on. The Indian Intercourse Act, this had to do with relationships on a commercial basis with many of the Native American tribes. Finally, on August 4th, they got around to approving the assumption of state debts. But you notice that follows the Residence Act. The Residence Act was the law that Congress passed that said the capital of the United States will be located on a 10-mile square area off the Potomac River, and they basically left it up to the president, George Washington, to determine where that would actually be. Once they agreed on that, shortly after, they agreed to the second part of the bargain between Hamilton, Madison, and Jefferson, which was the assumption of state debts. Then, of course, the tariff of 1790, they still had to continue raising money. The third session was held December 1790 through March 3rd of 1791. And during that time, they admitted Vermont as a new state, and they passed law creating the first bank of the United States. And if you don't think that was controversial, it was extremely controversial. In fact, when Hamilton presented it, there were cries that this is unconstitutional. Where do you read in the Constitution that it says we can create a bank? So George Washington called in Edmund Randolph, his attorney general, Hamilton, his secretary of the treasury, Jefferson, his secretary of state. He called them all together and said, I want your opinion. So they gave their opinion, and basically they all said it's unconstitutional, except Hamilton. Hamilton was so persuasive, they were able not only to convince Washington's small cabinet, but the Congress as well. And his argument was very simple. He said, doesn't Congress have the right to coin money, to regulate commerce, establish the value of our currency? He listed a number of financial transactions that that Congress had responsibility for in Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution. And after reading all of these financial rights and obligations, he said, the Constitution says, and Congress has the power to do all that is necessary and proper to carry into effect the foregoing powers. And he says, if I find it necessary to create a bank, what a better place to harbor the money of the federal government and to handle our taxes and to coin money. Necessary and proper. He argued that case, and he got his bank. By the way, that was finally decided in a Supreme Court case many years later called McCulloch versus Maryland, and they used Hamilton's argument to support the creation of a national bank. One of the most important things the first Congress did was to live up to a promise. During the ratification debates, there were a lot of reasons people hated the Constitution, many reasons why people loved the Constitution. But one that was very controversial was its lack of Bill of Rights. And we've discussed this in previous lectures. Many of the ratification conventions said, we will vote for the Constitution on the condition that the first Congress will draft a Bill of Rights. Now, there were almost 200 different proposals to amend the Constitution. And in fact, during discussions of this Bill of Rights, there were some members of Congress who were saying, let's just have another convention and fix it then. Many of the proposals were to guarantee supremacy of the legislature, to make sure that the federal government would not overpower the state governments. There were recommendations to limit the courts. There was a proposal to have a commission to overturn unpopular decisions of the Supreme Court, term limits for the president. There were all kinds of things that were being promoted. Well, Madison took it upon himself very early in the first Congress to give a speech before the Congress where he said, we've got to live up to this obligation for a Bill of Rights. So how do you take 150 to 200 recommendations and distill it down to 10. Well, you don't. You distill it down to 12. He took all of these, and he basically avoided the structural recommendations, such as presidential term limits, a commission to overturn Supreme Court decisions, and so on. And he primarily focused on the issues of rights, freedom of speech, freedom of press, freedom of assembly, Second Amendment, right to bear arms, trial by jury, habeas corpus. He took most of those, what we'd call fundamental rights, and he distilled them into 12 proposed amendments. Now, this also went through the committee process, but it was Madison who did the yeoman's work. On September 25th, the Congress submitted 12 proposals by the Congress to the states. Interestingly enough, there's no recorded vote in the House or the Senate, so we don't know how the members voted. But by December of 1791, December 15th, 10 of those amendments had been approved. Now, we know those as the Bill of Rights. You say, well, we thought there were 12 that were opposed. Why do we have 10? Because the first two were not ratified. Interestingly enough, the first one, which would have altered the number of individuals that each representative represented, is still pending. But number two on the list was ratified in 1992. And all it said was that Congress cannot give itself a pay raise. Well, they can vote a pay raise, but it does not take effect until the next Congress. So if I'm not in Congress, I don't get the pay raise. That was proposed in 1790 and became a part of the Constitution 200 years later. So when you hear people say, and this is funny, this I was on the way here tonight and I heard this on the radio again, a news commentator said, the First Amendment is the most important because of speech and press and religion. It's the most important, that's why it's number one. No, it's number one because the first two proposed amendments affecting salaries of members of Congress and the number of representatives each Congress would represent were rejected. So number three, which is about free speech and free press and so on, actually moved up to number one. So this is very important for this to happen. In summary, if you look what this first Congress did in the three sessions that it held, they created departments of state, war, treasury. They created the Supreme Court and the entire federal judicial system, the position of attorney general. They established a federal criminal code. They passed a Bill of Rights. They approved duties and tariffs and other ways of raising money for the government. They established the first Bank of the United States. They established the first census. They created the patent and copyright systems. They concluded a variety of treaties with the Indians and others. They added North Carolina, Rhode Island, and Vermont to the Union. The first Congress was extremely important in our history. And why should we care? Why is this important to us? Well, for one thing, the Constitution is based on us, on we the people. 100 years to the day after the Constitution was ratified on its centennial, the Prime Minister of England said the Constitution is the most wonderful work ever struck off at a given time by the brain and purpose of man. This Constitution has been the model for almost 200 countries around the world. It has been through a civil war. It has been through World War I, World War II, a civil rights movement. We've expanded rights. It's been amended. It has endured. But recently, a law professor, along with a number of others in this country, believe what she said. Every word of the Constitution, starting from this premise of we the people, is a lie. Now, you and I have a choice. We can either believe it's a lie and has been from the beginning, or we can realize what it is. It is a document that set up a government for the freest people in the history of the world. Is it perfect? No, that's why it's been amended on occasion. We extended the vote to women, to younger people. We eliminated slavery. We extended the vote to former slaves. So the Constitution has been improved, but never really abrogated in any significant way. There's an old saying, if we don't know where we've been, how do we know where we're going? Well, this is why we have to understand the principles behind the Constitution, why it was written the way it was written, the arguments on both sides of these principles, what their purposes were, because today there are questions that we need to be asking ourselves. Should the Electoral College be abolished? You hear people saying this sometime. Well, my answer isn't yes or no. My answer is, why do we have it? Why was it instituted? What service, what purpose did it serve in 1787? What purpose, if any, does it serve today? If you can't answer the why about the Electoral College, then let's not talk. Understand it before you argue for it. Should we have a constitutional convention? The Constitution provides that we could have another constitutional convention. Good idea or bad idea? Very interesting to ponder. Did the Constitution endorse slavery, or did it contain within it the seeds of its abolition? There are arguments on both sides, and they're good arguments. It needs to be discussed, but you can't discuss it if you don't understand why it was written and the compromises were made that were made. Does Congress give too much power to the other branches of government? My personal opinion is, yeah, I think they do. But how have they done it? Why have they done it? How can it be rectified? In short, there are many questions that we face today as we the people. And if we don't understand this glorious history, even though it was imperfect, no nation has done what we have done. Many have copied it. So we need to understand it because it protects us. It belongs to us. And we need to fully understand it. Thank you so much, and we'll take any questions if there are any.
Well, thank you, Joellen. We do have one question. Julie from online asks, I saw the musical Hamilton last week at the Segerstrom, and there was a song called The Adams Administration with the lyrics that sang, Adams fired Hamilton. Was the animosity portrayed between Alexander Hamilton and John Adams real, or was it played up for the drama of the stage?
Well, I have not seen the musical Hamilton, if you can believe that. I hear it's wonderful. But no, there was a lot of animosity between John Adams and Hamilton, but between John Adams and a lot of people. John Adams had a short temper. He was very concerned about his presence, how people perceived him. He was also one of the smartest men in the founding. He was absolutely brilliant. But he was just a little quirky and just had a habit of not getting along with people, even people he agreed with. He and Washington often agreed, but there just wasn't that kind of camaraderie. So I would have not seen Hamilton the musical. I would say it's probably representing what was pretty well true.
All right. Well, thank you for answering it. That's our one question for tonight. And thank you.
Thank you.